Patrick Leahy accusing the Saudi Crown Prince, MBS's government, of being a, quote, criminal enterprise in the murder of Jamal Khashoggi and jailing of Dr. Walid Fitaihi. Dr. Fitaihi is an American. He has been held in Saudi without charges for nearly 17 months. Fitaihi got his medical degree, did his training at George Washington University and Harvard, living in the United States for decades before returning to Riyadh to start a hospital. Fitaihi was helping people, also talking about human rights, when he was arrested in the Crown Prince's purge, first detained at the Ritz-Carlton Hotel with 200 others, then put in prison where he is still held now without any charges. His family says he's being beaten and tortured. Today, his son met with Leahy and other members of Congress, but President Trump remains silent. Out front now, Dr. Fitaihi's son, Ahmad. And Ahmad, thank you very much. You were there. You were with your father when he was arrested more than a year ago. What happened?
Basically, what happened was one day, me and my dad were sitting in his office chatting, when suddenly we heard a knock on the door. We opened the door, and it's a group of at least 6 to 7 police officers dressed as civilians. They grab my dad extremely aggressively, and they take him to the side. At that time, they promised that they just wanted to talk, you know. So they said that he's going to return by the time lunch is ready. He'll be ready. He'll be back home, which is in a couple of hours. Which, as we all know, that was a lie, because 1.5 years later, and he's still there.
And so he's rounded up, along with other people that in most all cases, were not charged at the Ritz, and he ends up in prison. Did you ever get any updates, anything about where he was, what they were doing, anything at all?
Well, that's the most frustrating part about all this. I mean, since the beginning, I've been watching this case, and the first couple of months, we said, you know what, let's play the patience game. Let's give them their time. Maybe this is a misunderstanding. So we waited. After that, we said, okay, what's the next step? The next step is, let's navigate through the Saudi legal system. So we looked for a Saudi lawyer. The problem was, not one lawyer wanted to touch this. It was radioactive. Nobody wants to touch this.
Because it was perceived that the Crown Prince is on the other side.
Exactly. And it's out of fear and obviously security of their own safety. You know, they don't want to take the case. So I was left with no choice but to come here to the U.S., and try to raise the issue on the higher-ups, you know. So I went to, I spoke with the Congress, and I went up to the Hill, and they've been actually very helpful.
You were with him on the day he was arrested.
That's correct.
You then decided you wanted to try to, you were doing everything you could to try to help him get out.
That's correct.
So you go to the airport.
Yes.
And you go again and again and again, and they don't let you out.
Yeah.
Finally, somebody lets you out.
Yeah.
You come here.
Yes.
Because you have a U.S. passport.
Yes.
But then what do they do to the rest of your family?
They go and they take both my family's Saudi and U.S. passports.
So no one else can leave?
Yes, no one else can leave. Not only that, they have frozen all our accounts. So it's extremely hard to move since we have, for all of us, 9 American citizens. Mm-hmm. You know, we're two people away from becoming an American football team. You know, we're an extremely big group of people. So that also plays a big role in our inability to move.
So, since your father was detained, the Secretary of State for the United States, Mike Pompeo, White House Senior Advisor Jared Kushner, have been over to Saudi Arabia. There have been multiple visits. Neither of them have taken this issue or raised it, thus, as far as we know. The President, President Trump, has backed the Saudi Crown Prince, Mohammed bin Salman, even though American intelligence concluded he personally directed the brutal murder of American resident Jamal Khashoggi. Here's how President Trump responded when he was asked about Khashoggi's death.
I hate the crime. I hate what's done. I hate the cover-up. And I will tell you this, the Crown Prince hates it more than I do. And they have vehemently denied it.
I know that's hard to hear, Ahmad.
Yeah.
Why do you think he says that? Why do you think he does stay silent about your dad?
To be honest, it's really, I think about this every single day, honestly, and it doesn't make sense to me at all. I mean, he's one of the most law-abiding citizens ever. It's the easiest black and white case ever. Just, you know, it's clearly a misunderstanding of some sort, or the government has arrested him on false pretenses, and now is trying to fabricate a case that doesn't exist.
So, Ahmad, if your dad is watching, if he sees this, What do you want to say to him?
I want to tell him I'm going to do everything I can to save him. I love him. Hang in there, Bubba.
Well, I hope that this is heard, and I hope that you see your dad soon.
Thank you.
Your mom, all your brothers and sisters you have been separated from. I know you can't go back. They can't come here. It's just terrible.
Appreciate that a lot.
Thank you so very much, Ahmad.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
And here's hoping the Trump administration will take a stand, okay? I can tell you, I have the support of the police, the support of the military, the support of the bikers for Trump. I have the tough people, but they don't play it tough until they go to a certain point. And then it would be very bad, very bad. Abby Phillip is out front at the White House. Abby, this sounds like a threat.
Well, sir, a lot of people are certainly taking it that way, Erin, and it's not the first time that President Trump has used almost identical language to talk about his supporters in this way, talking about the military, the bikers for Trump, and others who he says are tough, and tough in a very specific way. The president also implying in this quote that the left is tough, too. He used this language when he was talking about Antifa, saying that his supporters might be able to go up against Antifa at a campaign rally back in September in Missouri. And many people remember back in the campaign, President Trump talked about Second Amendment people, referring to people who advocate for gun rights in this country, being able to stop Hillary Clinton from appointing judges, left-leaning judges to the court if she were elected president. So this is a president who has repeatedly used this kind of language, sometimes playing fast and loose with his words and leaving it open to interpretation for people to believe that this is a door open to people who might want to use violence in the public sphere. The president almost never clarifies, and the White House certainly doesn't either, but a lot of people raising more questions about the president's language here and why he doesn't do more to be clearer about his words if violence is not in fact what he is implying here, Erin.
All right, Abby, thank you very much, and a really good point, right? If violence isn't what you're trying to talk about, then why are you talking about things getting very bad when you're talking about your supporters as the police and the military as monolithic groups? Out front now, Steve Cortez. He's on President Trump's 2020 reelect advisory council, and Keith Boykin, former Clinton White House aide. Keith, when you hear the president say things could get very bad, if police and military, the police, the military get tough, what do you think he's saying?
I think he's clearly threatening violence, or hinting at the possibility of violence. It's a part of a pattern that we've seen from Donald Trump going back to the presidential campaign, when he would consistently talk about he wanted to punch people in the face, tell people to knock the crap out of protesters. He offered to pay the legal bills for people who roughed up protesters. He just consistently behaved in a way that was detrimental to creating a collegial atmosphere in a presidential race. And he doesn't show any sense of he's learned anything since he's become president.
Steve?
You know, look, I think it's important here to be very precise in talking about what the president actually said. And he did not in any way infer or say that he was going to use the military, meaning in an official capacity, or the police in any way. What he's saying is among those groups, he has enormous support. And that's very clearly true. And he's saying that those groups can defensively act with force if they have to, because there is no doubt that violence from
Steve,
the left is all around
talking
the country.
About having the military in a violent confrontation with the left in this country?
No, I just said the opposite. I'm saying supporters of his
to. Who...
No. This is exactly what I'm saying, Erin. He's not saying the military or the police are going to take action. He is saying that among those groups, he has enormous support. Many, in
you
fact,
did
most
say that, but then you
continued
to say they could
people,
ride, they could fight
okay.
in defense.
And he said
and I'm saying
very,
as
very
individuals...
Bad.
No. And as individuals, not as a military force, not as police forces, as individuals, if they need to, they will defend themselves, because we've seen a marked rise in serious violence from the left, from Antifa and from other groups. Look, they are you can't blow this off. They are shooting congressmen. They are punching student activists in the face. They are rousting speakers from podiums on campuses across this country. And what he's saying is his supporters are tired of being pushed around.
Steve,
it's never okay to instigate violence, but it is very okay to defend defend yourself, and he's saying that if that's necessary, if the left continues the prevalence of violence, that his supporters will be forced to defend themselves.
Steve, we've never had a president like this before who's not only encouraged violence in his campaign while a black woman in Louisville was pushed around, or a black man in Fayetteville was punched in the face. We saw that during the actual presidency of this guy. He went to Montana and he praised Greg Gianforte, a congressman, for body slamming a reporter. We have people who are out there who are Trump supporters who are sending bombs to this office at CNN where I sit today. People who have been engaging in violent activity. The President of the United States has encouraged this type of behavior, or at least hinted that he doesn't disapprove of it. When Charlottesville happened, when violent people were actually marching with tiki torches in Charlottesville, the president said they were very fine people. This is a guy who has a history of stoking
them.
He said they were very fine people on both sides. This is a guy who has a history
of stoking the flames of the monument
debate. Violence.
That's an incredibly important distinction. He said there were both fine people on both sides of the monument debate.
Were roughing up people in his campaign rallies. Why did he go to the police chiefs and tell them that it was okay to engage in police brutality and rough up suspects? Why did he invite Ted Nugent to come to the White House for an Oval Office photo op after Ted Nugent threatened Hillary Clinton, Barack Obama with a machine gun? This guy has a history of playing loose with his words, and it's not helpful in a country that's already on the edge.
When you talk about a country edge, can I just play what Michael Cohen said last week? Forget the messenger for a moment, Steve. Let me just play what he said.
Well,
given my experience working for Mr. Trump, I fear that if he loses the election in 2020, that there will never be a peaceful transition of power. And this is why I agreed to appear before you today.
There are people who have that fear. A lot of people. There's people on the left, there's people on the right. When the president says, I have the support of the police and the military, and if the other side plays it tough, it'll get to a certain point and then it would be very bad, very bad. Isn't that the specter that a lot of people hear, Steve?
No. Now, listen, I think he should be more careful with his words. I do. I think, for example, during this interview, he should have said, it's never okay to instigate political violence. Never. It's okay to defend yourself. It's not okay to be an instigator. And I wish he had said that.
But, Steve, he doesn't say it. He knows he could say it. He chooses not to say it.
No. Look, here's the difference, though. I think what you're doing tonight, Erin, and what media has done to him since he entered politics is always ascribe the very most nefarious interpretation possible of his words. The American people don't hear him that way, though. We hear him as somebody who speaks very plainly, who doesn't speak in a lawyerly or political manner. So, for instance, when he said, and Abby mentioned in the preview to this story, she mentioned that, and I had to fight this a lot during the campaign, she mentioned his talking about the Second Amendment supporters who could stop Hillary. What he meant was not that they were going to shoot Hillary. He meant that they could use their political power as a political force to stop her judges, if necessary, in the Senate,
if she were
to become president and nominate
anti-Second Amendment people. Hold on. Everyone stop for a second. I'm going to play some things that he said. The last one is the one about Hillary and the Second Amendment. I'm going to play it.
Knock the crap out of them, would you? Seriously. Okay? Just knock the hell. I promise you, I will pay for the legal fees, I promise. I love the old days. You know what they used to do to guys like that when they were in a place like this? They'd be carried out on a stretcher, folks. Hillary wants to essentially abolish the Second Amendment. By the way, and if she gets to pick her judges, nothing you can do, folks. Although the Second Amendment people, maybe there is, I don't know.
Yeah, this guy has a history of playing loose with his words, intentionally designed to stir up and fan the flames of fear. Remember, Steve, when he went out there and he said he could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue and he wouldn't lose a supporter. This is a guy who knows that his supporters are on the edge. He wants to tee them up to the point where during the 2016 campaign, he was even threatening that he wouldn't even accept the election results.
That was a very funny comment from him.
No, it's not funny for the President of the United States to threaten to murder somebody and to think that he has no consequences for doing so.
He didn't mean it was a joke. But here's the thing. You you can't have it both ways, okay? Because here's what I hear constantly from the left, that he's a feckless president, right, who can't get anything through Congress, can't even pass a bill through the Senate for his own Republicans to back him on the border. But at the same time, he's a tyrant and a dictator who's going to use national security forces to enforce his rule. Well, which is it? Because those two things aren't, you know, don't jive. If he had the tendencies that he's being accused of by people like
just
Michael Cohen,
a, have just no idea where bad, he gets his evidence. Just because he's not good at being a dictator doesn't mean he's not trying. Let's just leave it at
okay,
that.
Okay, final
so
words.
He's an incompetent dictator?
That's the best you could probably say for him at this point.
Okay.
I wish the president had been more careful with his words in this case. I do. But I
also believe that
we on the right, when we are attacked by Antifa, by leftist violence, I live in Chicago and I was at the rally that was shut down by a violent mob in this city that attacked police and Trump supporters. I think the Trump supporters have to be ready to defend themselves.
I'm in a building
and that's
where
what the
pipe bombs were sent.
Nobody should be implying that
Trump
violence
supporter.
Is an acceptable way to deal with political disagreement. And that's what comments like this imply. That's the fundamental issue. And I think we all agree political violence is unacceptable and un-American. So let's agree on that. Thank you both. And Out Front next.
I'm just going to be me, you know. I'm going to run for everyone, run with everyone, listen to everybody.
Beto O'Rourke is running for president. But which issues is he running on? And the prosecutor who helped put declaring to Vanity Fair that he was born to be in it. Former Democratic congressman from Texas, Beto O'Rourke, announced his candidacy for president today, kicking off his run in Iowa, explaining how he says he will differentiate himself from the more than dozen candidates he is vying for the Democratic nomination. He says one big way that he's going to be different is just to be himself.
I'm just going to be me, you know. I'm going to run for everyone, run with everyone, listen to everybody, try to answer every question. But this very divided moment in our country, people want to come together. They want to see us do something bigger than we would otherwise be able to do on our own.
So he grabbed the attention of his Democratic opponents, who jumped right in. Kamala Harris, unafraid, deploying his name in a fundraising email right away. And he also got the attention of his Republican rival as well.
Well, I think he's got a lot of hand movement. I've never seen so much hand movement. I said, is he crazy or is that just the way he acts?
More on that later on in the show. Only Jeannie can handle that particular comment perfectly. Now let's go to Patrick Healy, political editor for The New York Times, Nia Malika Henderson, our senior political reporter, and Sasha Eisenberg, author of The Victory Lab, The Secret Science of Winning Campaigns. All right, Patrick. So this announcement comes hand in hand with a very fancy, glossy Annie Leibovitz cover. You know, by that it means, you know, posed. I mean, you know, I mean, she's the top of the top when it comes to this. Okay. How much real substance is there behind him? What do we really know about Beto O'Rourke's policy?
Right. We know that he was not Ted Cruz in 2018. That was very exciting down in Texas. But in terms of substance, you know, on immigration, he's got an El Paso message that he can certainly talk about getting rid of the border wall down there. He's able to speak with authenticity around that. On climate change, on health care, on other kind of standard Democratic issues, he's more center-left than really progressive like Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders. But what you're getting at, Erin, is central here. It's not the policies that are exciting people. It's the, frankly, the guy who can be packaged to be on a Vanity Fair cover. This is who Barack Obama eventually became in the summer of 2008 when he was getting these huge, huge rallies and he was sort of a rock star and John McCain derided him as sort of a celebrity candidate. Right now, you know, Beto O'Rourke needs to show that he believes in something and isn't going to go down the trail of inviting questions about kind of the where's the beef question,
right.
You know, what does he really
stand
for?
I'm running for everyone and with everyone and,
yeah,
and, you know,
and
sounds
the
good,
dangers
but what is
of
it?
Him and the dangers of him getting ahead of himself and saying I was born to do this without sort of showing he's either earned it or deserves it is a question.
And those are crucial questions. So, Sasha, here's what you know, right? Obviously, he lost to Ted Cruz, but he's a three-term former congressman. Obviously, Ted Cruz sort of made him famous right, with that loss. You've spent a lot of time with him, covering him, Sasha. Is he ready to take on Trump?
I think from the perspective of somebody running a campaign, he proved himself remarkably credible last year. I mean, he raised more money than any candidate for Senate ever. He had, by the end of the campaign, 830 people on his field staff, which is roughly the same size as Donald Trump's entire national campaign payroll by the end of 2012. And so, you know, to the extent that the candidate is the CEO of a, you know, strategic and marketing organization, I think he acquitted himself pretty well. That's some preparation to run. I think the stuff Patrick talks about, you know, can he talk about foreign policy? That was not something that was ever really demanded of him. And he was able to, you know, he didn't have a primary contest last year, so he didn't get a lot of tough scrutiny from, he didn't have a serious primary contest, so he didn't get a lot of tough scrutiny from sort of liberal interest groups.
Yeah.
And in the general election, people across the spectrum in Texas were able to project onto him a lot of what they wanted to project onto him, and he was very good at being all things to all people.
And that, of course, is you know, something you can do for a while until you can't. I mean, Nia, earlier this year, O'Rourke wrote a blog post, and he talked about being on a road trip, you know, that he was tired out from the Senate race. He was trying to get out of a, quote, funk that he'd been in since losing. He described, you know, the fog, the confusion, you know, there's a lot of poetic posts there. You wrote a piece for CNN about it, and you wrote in part, quote, this could never, ever be a woman. Betsy O'Rourke, as Patrick was saying, if she wrote about being in a funk, that would be a big problem. But for him, it did not hurt. Does he seem aware of the privilege he has?
You know, in some ways, no. And this, of course, came up in the article that I had written this piece. And I guess Amy, his wife, bristled at the notion that I was supposedly criticizing him for leaving his kids at home. And she said, well, he wasn't, you know, leaving the kids at home. I was there to take care of them, which is exactly the point that I was making, which was that his white male privilege enabled him to, you know, leave his house, leave the kids because he had a wife at home. And also, you know, the idea that he could give an interview to the Washington Post and a question about immigration came up, and he was pretty comfortable in saying that he didn't know that. I don't think a woman could do that. I don't think an African-American candidate or minority candidate could do that either. This idea that if you're a woman candidate or a minority candidate, you have to be twice as good to get half as far. And I think a lot of the candidates we've seen, Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton, sort of embodied that in a way that we aren't seeing from Beto O'Rourke at this point.
And now the president, though, Patrick, of course, takes him seriously. He likes to talk about many of his rivals, but he has not been hesitant to talk about the guy he calls Beto. Here he is.
Mm-hmm. I think Beto O'Rourke is highly overrated. When I heard about him, I figured he must be something a little special. He's not. He pretends to be a moderate, but he's actually a radical, open borders left winger. That's what he is. The young man who's got very little going for himself, except he's got a great first name. I think that's probably the end of his political career.
Trump knows every time he says someone's name, he helps them out, or even doesn't say their name, right?
So
what's the strategy?
Yeah, I mean, Trump usually attacks when someone's getting under his own skin. I mean, he took on Elizabeth Warren and belittled her with sort of the racist nickname, you know, Pocahontas, because Elizabeth Warren, you know, was pretty fearless in calling him out. You know, she went right for him, and that's where he goes. That's where he goes. I mean, his comment about Beto O'Rourke seems to have something wrong with his hand, sort of uncomfortably for me, brought up, you know, Trump mocking a colleague of mine at the, you know, at the New York Times, who has a physical disability. Trump, he decides to go personal very quickly and likes to sort of make fun of people, even if it's not based in any kind of reality.
So one thing, though, the first day of O'Rourke's campaign, Sasha, today, he flipped on a very, very big issue, an important issue that's going to be very central to this election. Here he is today and then at our town hall, which was just a few months ago.
I think the American people are going to have a chance to decide this at the ballot box in November 2020, and perhaps that's the best way for us to resolve these outstanding questions. I do think there's enough there for impeachment, and if asked, I would vote on it.
Okay, now he wants it at the ballot box. If asked, I'd vote on it was a few months ago. Does a flip-flop like that, everyone's got to evolve, Sasha, but is something like that an issue?
Yeah, and actually over the course of last year, he adjusted between being open to beginning an impeachment proceeding and whether he would vote for it. I mean, there's some pressure has been relieved. He's no longer in Congress. And so he is not going to have to face a vote on this. And I think that all the Democrats are going to have to deal with the fact that the facts are going to change in the next 6 months, in the next 12 months. We'll learn things when the Mueller report comes out. We will learn things in congressional hearings. And my guess is that No Democrat will have the same position on this or the same language on it now that they do when people start caucusing in Iowa.
Yeah, from your editorial, you write, quote, O'Rourke, tall, handsome, white, and male, has this latitude to be and do anything. His privilege even allows him to turn a loss to the most despised candidate of the cycle into a launching pad for a White House run. Has O'Rourke miscalculated, Mia? Is 2020 the wrong year for someone of his profile, his description?
You know, I don't think we know yet, and this has come up in that Vanity Fair article, this idea that somehow he is disadvantaged because of his race and gender, because he's a white man in a field, according to this article, where Democrats are yearning for either Cory Booker or Kamala Harris. None of the metrics so far show that somebody like Kamala Harris or somebody like Cory Booker is tailor-made for this moment or this field. At this point, Joe Biden is leading, Bernie Sanders is leading in terms of fundraising. So I don't think it's really sort of credible to argue that being white and male is going to hurt this candidate at all. I think in many ways it's going to be an advantage for him. It allows him to be all things to all people, as Sasha was talking about.
All right. Thank you all. And next, a man Team Trump loved to hate.
Andrew Weissman. You know who Andrew Weissman is. He's a complete scoundrel.
And now Robert Mueller's star prosecutor is leaving the team. Does that mean it's time for the Mueller report? And an American detained in Saudi Arabia, in prison, allegedly tortured, yet a storied prosecutor, one of the first to join, the one who led the case against the Trump campaign chairman, Paul Manafort, and someone that Team Trump has regularly attacked.
Andrew Weissman, you know who Andrew Weissman is. He's a complete scoundrel.
Andrew Weissman would be regarded by many defense lawyers and prosecutors as a disgrace.
Disgrace, scoundrel. Out front now, former Nixon White House counsel John Dean. So John, we know Rudy Giuliani thinks. What does Weissman's departure tell you about where Mueller is? Is he done?
Well, it doesn't just necessarily he is totally done. It looks like a phase of his operation is done. I'm told he's not only a good prosecutor and good in a courtroom, but he's also a good administrator and good at running investigations. So it looks like with the Manafort case wrapped and Gates pleading, that sort of heavy financial angle has come to an end. I think that the counterintelligence part of this investigation
conspiracy
is probably going to be ongoing for several years.
Wow. But so do you think Mueller will put out some interim report on where he is, or you actually think everybody is completely wrong on where this is?
I think what's going to happen is people overestimated what his report is going to be. The regs just call for him to explain, you know, why did he decline or why did he prosecute somebody? And that's really all he has to report. So I don't think there will be much more than that. It'll be pretty bare bones.
And then you're saying the conspiracy part would continue for several years. That would have
the counterintelligence, the counterintelligence part.
All right. So I want to ask you, you know, the context of all of this, of course, is everybody talking about, you know, your role and Nixon. And we have a new series coming out, Tricky Dick, which looks at Nixon's life, but his career and life all together and some of the parallels that exist between then and now. Here's a brief clip, John.
The tougher it gets, the cooler I get. I have what it takes.
Impeach Nixon now! Impeach Nixon now!
I want to say this to the television audience, because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
This crap about Watergate.
Let others wallow in Watergate. We're going to do our job.
Briefly, you appeared in that clip, and of course, you know, your testimony before Congress at that time was crucial, right? You told Nixon the Watergate cover-up was a cancer on the presidency. When you said that, that played a huge role in his eventual resignation, that huge moment in history. What do you think is going to happen here? Are we going to have more hearings, impeachment hearings? What happens here?
I think this is a little different in Watergate in the sense that Watergate, you actually had hearings going on while you had a special prosecutor investigating. They were both parallel activities. They would evolve into an impeachment inquiry based on the information that really Nixon had no answer for, and his tapes were so telling that he decided he didn't want to try to fight it even. I don't see an exact parallel here, but I do see the oversight in the House that's beginning now is going to educate voters about what's really going on.
All right. Thank you very much, John Dean.
Thank you.
And don't miss Tricky Dick. It premieres this Sunday at 9 p.m. Eastern, only on CNN. And next, a U.S. citizen detained, allegedly tortured in Saudi Arabia. His family wants to know why President Trump remains silent. His son is out front in his first television interview. And on a much lighter note this evening,